Yeah, because then Kathy can slip out. Yeah. Sure. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Will Marshall, president of the Progressive Policy Institute, and I want to welcome you today to this forum on growing the transatlantic digital economy. Thank you very much for coming out on a beautiful fall Friday. This is the third collaboration between the Lisbon Council and the Progressive Policy Institute. We have been in Brussels for the previous two engagements, two wonderful forums this spring and the previous spring, on the digital, the rise of the data-driven economy, digital trade, and the prospect of barriers to that digital trade and what it might mean for growth on both sides of the Atlantic. And I want to extend a warm welcome to Paul Hoffeins and Ann Mettler, who are our partners, the president and executive director, respectively, of the Lisbon Council. And they've been tremendous partners, not just partners in putting on forums, but co-authoring reports, which you've seen outside, I hope, and just gracious hosts when we've been in Brussels. So it's great to have you here in Washington. You're just in time for a thrilling baseball, the conclusion of the baseball season. Having had two away games in Brussels, this is a homestand in Washington. We thought it was very important to bring this conversation to Washington and the policymaker audience here. And I want to acknowledge our third partner today, and that's Georgetown University and McDonough School of Business and the Center for Business and Public Policy, whose executive director is John Mayo. John, thank you very much for hosting us today and being our partner. We also want to welcome a very special guest, Neelie Kroes, who is vice president of the European Commission, responsible for the digital. Sorry? Pardon me. Bad verb tense. Is until November. Vice President of the European Commission, responsible for the digital agenda. She's been a real hero of ours. We've never met, but we've watched from afar as she has championed the open internet and fought to convince Europeans in officialdom in the EU that Europeans can reap the benefits of big data, of open data flows, without sacrificing trust and security and privacy. And of course, this is the big issue. How we do that is critically important. I also want to welcome our friend Kathy Novelli, Undersecretary of State for Economic Growth, Energy, and Environment, which sounds like an impossible portfolio, by the way. Anybody knows Kathy knows she can handle it. She's been one of America's leading trade negotiators, deeply versed in transatlantic issues, and also has a great tech background, which really equips her to speak knowledgeably to today's topic. We're very fortunate, too, to have as our moderator Karen Dunfried, who is president of the German Marshall Fund and also someone steeped in transatlantic policy and politics. And very grateful that she will come today, and I'll say a few more words about Karen when I turn it over to her. After we hear from this panel, we will have a second distinguished roundtable that Paul Hoffeins is going to moderate. So why is this transatlantic dialogue so important to PPI? Why do we invest so much time in it? And I think it's fundamentally for this reason, that both sides of this partnership, the United States and the European Union, suffer from the same basic malady. And that is what the economists call secular stagnation and what the rest of us call slow growth. It's really dramatically seen in the OECD's latest forecast, which downgraded growth prospects in Europe to 0.8% this year, 1.1% next year. That's pretty meager. We look at some of the big economies in Europe, like France and Italy, which are essentially dead in the water. In the United States, the picture's somewhat better. OECD forecast is for 2.1% growth this year, but this comes after a long period of stagnation. We've grown less than 2% GDP growth since 2000 in this country. And even as we see job growth coming back in the United States, job creation is beginning to look better. We still see the median wage declining over the last 3 years, which is unprecedented in the so-called recovery. You see the median wage falling. It should be rising. So we are underperforming economically, too, and it seems to us that both sides need to think carefully about how we can break out of this slow growth rut. To do that, we've got to tap new sources of growth, new sources of investment. One, obviously, is trade. We are in the middle of a great negotiation over TTIP, which we hope will be successful. That's going to be an important contributor to growth. But another, and what we're really focused on today, is data-driven innovation, which, based on the work we've done here in the United States and others have done, is really the bright spot in our otherwise agonizingly slow recovery in the United States. Tremendous investment, tremendous job growth, tremendous innovation and dynamism in this sector, in contrast to almost all the others except energy, which is the other boom sector. In any case, this is unfortunately an underappreciated phenomenon, we think, in official Washington. And one of the reasons people don't understand the economic potential of data-driven innovation is because we don't measure it properly. So PPI, under the direction of Michael Mandel, our chief economic strategist, whom we'll hear from later today, has really tried to rectify that by documenting robust job growth in app development, a new industry, didn't exist before 2007. Tremendous job growth there, big data analytics and processing and storage, great job gains there, and tech occupations in general spread across the whole economy, which have really been growing rapidly. And Michael's also focused on the Internet of Everything and its potential to extend the productivity gains we've seen in the internet and digital space to the rest of the economy. But all this promise is jeopardized by the specter of digital protectionism. You know, we've got calls for data localization that we see around the world. That's actually happened in Russia, maybe not surprisingly, passed a law to require companies that want to do business to locate servers in Russia. The Snowden backlash in Europe has been pretty fierce. I think we all recognize, and there have been calls there from no less exalted people than Chancellor Merkel for a European cloud or a European internet to prevent data transfers to the U.S. personal data of Europeans. Our governments are in talks to toughen the safe harbor framework that's enabled, facilitated data transfers for all these years. And of course, everyone is anxiously awaiting the approval by the European Commission of the data protection regulations, which I guess will happen next year, and which, frankly, many U.S. companies fear would undermine their competitiveness in Europe and maybe even prevent them from doing business there. The last thing we need in the transatlantic area is a digital trade war. This would be an act of mutual assured economic destruction. So the question we've been raising is, how can we revive the old habits of transatlantic cooperation at a time when that increasingly seems to be a strategic priority, thanks to chaos in the neighborhood that we don't need to go into here? We hope that our government will show the requisite urgency in trying to push these TTIP negotiations to a successful conclusion and to offer reassurances such as we can on surveillance, data protection, and privacy to smooth the way for some kind of understanding on data flows and privacy. This is the snag. This is the thing we're snagged on, and I don't know if that happens. The Europeans insisted that not happen within the TTIP framework. Maybe it happens in the safe harbor negotiations, but in some way we need to have an understanding about data flows and privacy that allows for free trade, free cross-border trade in data. And certainly Europe and the United States have a shared interest in fending off bad ideas for subjecting the internet to national regulation. I mean, it's obvious that there's a lot of resentment around the world when the United States argues for this decentralized multi-stakeholder model of governance for the internet. People see it as just a mask for, fronting for the interests of American companies that are dominant platform providers. But we've got to keep in mind that this light touch approach to internet regulation is a huge policy success that enabled the exponential growth of the internet. So finally, we think that this candid dialogue with our European friends and partners is absolutely crucial. We need to elevate these issues in Brussels and in Washington, which is why we're here, redouble our efforts to find common ground. Because after all, who will defend the open internet and the free flow of data if not the world's open and free societies? So that's why we're here, and thank you all for coming. Now I'd like to turn it over to Ann Lettler, who is the executive director and co-founder of the Lisbon Council, for some brief remarks.
Thank you so much, Will, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. It's great to be here now that I've gotten over my jet lag. So also on behalf of the Lisbon Council, a very warm welcome to today's event. The Lisbon Council, let me just say, for those of you who don't know, we're a knowledge economy think tank based in Brussels. And of course, coming from Europe this morning, I have to say how overjoyed we are about what happened in Scotland yesterday. I know it doesn't really have anything to do with digital, but I think we all just breathe a collective sigh of relief. So very good news on this front. But now back to the Lisbon Council and really the topic that we're discussing here today. And we are, of course, deeply engaged in Europe's digital agenda, which recently, just last week, actually received a major boost because the new Commission President, Jean-Claude Juncker, really upgraded the portfolio. He really mainstreamed digital within the European Commission, which is something that Vice President Kroes, of course, always called for. So, you know, this is very important, and I won't go into any further detail, but just to say, I think that this issue of digital will be taken much more seriously in Europe going forward. I could go into many issues, trade and data, all of that, but just to say also there's a geopolitical backdrop. Maybe we feel it more in Europe, but really an authoritarian Russia, chaos in the Middle East, you know. I mean, there's so much happening in the world, and if we, Europe and the United States, cannot come together over issues that we should to solve as democracies, as countries that believe in openness, then I really worry. And I think this is also at the heart of our collaboration here today. Now, before I hand over back to you, Will, or to Karen, I don't even know, but let me say what a pleasure also for us it has been to collaborate with you. It has been a transatlantic collaboration, but as you said, so far it has only taken place in Brussels, so we're delighted to be here today. And also just to say thank you to Georgetown University and for this absolutely amazing venue here today. I don't think you would see anything like this in Europe, at least not outside of the UK, unfortunately. But finally, I also have to say a very, very warm thank you to Neelie Kroes. I know you will soon step down from your position, but I am deeply convinced that what happened last week and the elevation that digital received and the new commission is actually your doing. You put this on the map, you brought it to the highest attention of policymakers, really to heads of government, and we owe you so much, and I hope you know that. And I really say this, thank you from the bottom of my heart. And with that, I hand over, thank you. So back to you, Will. Thank you, and back to Will.
Thank you very much, Anna. Now I just want to hand off to Karen to get the program started, but you've got bio information, I think, on everybody, but I just want to say that in addition to her role at the helm of the German Marshall Fund, and everybody knows what a pivotal organization that is in the transatlantic relationship, Karen served as President Obama's principal advisor on Europe on the National Security Council previously and handled the Europe portfolio at State Department and National Intelligence Council, so we could hardly ask for a better and more adept moderator for the session. So over to you, Karen.
Thanks so much, Will. Well, welcome to everybody. It's great to be here, and kudos to PPI and the Lisbon Council for focusing us all on this critical issue in the transatlantic relationship, and also for bringing together the two key senior policymakers from both sides of the Atlantic to look at this. And in my world, both in the policy world and at GMF, this issue of the transatlantic digital economy has been, on the one hand, one of great promise, but also one of great controversy, particularly over the past year. And it's been the case that even before the Snowden revelations, this was a contentious issue in the transatlantic relationship. In part, it's because Europe has been skeptical of the US's digital dominance and has scrutinized many US companies for alleged monopolistic behavior, whether it was Microsoft, Intel, or Google. There have been reports of US government requests for user data from companies such as Yahoo and Facebook have created more friction on that issue of transatlantic data flows in the minds of Europeans who understandably feel strongly about safeguarding their personal information. And then when you added to that the revelations about NSA surveillance, it added not only this private sector aspect, but it affected relations between countries. And GMF just last week published its most recent annual survey of public opinion. And it was so striking, particularly in the case of Germany, to see 20 percentage point drops in German attitudes towards the US. And when we briefed Germans with that data, every one of them said, this is the impact of Snowden. So we've seen this issue play in the private sector and also in government-to-government relations. At the same time, as this conference highlights, there's a real potential for growth in this area. And certainly, Europeans also see the promise of that at a time when all of our economies are looking for growth. And so one of the questions is, can you implement a digital agenda on the EU level or national level, and it's equally important in a country like Germany, that boosts growth and creates those added benefits, but then doesn't actually result in greater protectionism? And you've spoken very eloquently to this as well, but those are some of the issues that I'm looking to our two speakers to help us unpack this morning. And Will did a great job of introducing my two companions here on the stage, but I want to say a little bit more about each of them. To my immediate left, we have Neelie Kroes, who is a vice president of the European Commission, and she is the European Digital Agenda Commissioner. She had a distinguished political career in the Netherlands before moving to European level, and prior to her current post, she was the Commissioner for Competition from 2004 to 2009. She came from the Netherlands. She had been the president of a business school at a very well-regarded university in the Netherlands, and started her career at the Rotterdam Municipal Council, and then was a member of the Dutch Parliament, and also served as Minister for Transport, Public Works, and Telecommunications in the Netherlands. So she brings an incredibly rich set of experiences to her current position and has been highlighted. She's played a really critical role in this debate over the past year. And then to her left, we have Kathy Novelli, who is the Undersecretary for Economic Growth, Energy, and Environment. And what's wonderful about what she brings to this position is she also is coming directly from the private sector. And she was, up until April, the vice president of worldwide government affairs at Apple. I think we've all heard of Apple. And prior to that, she was a partner at the venerable law firm Mayer Brown. And then she has deep government experience. She spent many years at the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, held a succession of important positions there. The last one was as Assistant U.S. Trade Representative for Europe and the Mediterranean, where she had a huge portfolio of 65 countries. But perhaps most importantly for our conversation this morning, she was the point person for the $1 trillion economic relationship between the United States and Europe. So we couldn't have a better duo to talk about this issue this morning. I'm gonna first turn to Vice President Kroes and then to Undersecretary Novelli, so please.
Good morning, everybody. It's such a pleasure to be together with Kathy, for I'm one of her admirers, and we are cooperating in a very constructive way. Having said that, it was a long time that I did have blushes on my cheeks, but thank you for your nice words. By the way, that's also putting you back to reality. And some of you know the story. I do have two grandchildren, US citizens, 4 and 6 years old, living in San Francisco, and Skyping every Sunday afternoon. And more pleasure for me than for them. But okay, they still are behaving. And at a certain moment, one of them was asking, by the way, how old are you? And I said at that time, 72. And she said, you're still alive. So you can imagine that I'm in a hurry. So for life is not eternity, so to say. And having said that, and that is also just a fact that I'm registering, and rightly said, with the new commission to be, and normally spoken somewhere in November, and with that main priority, the digital single market. It's also a fact that I will be replaced by three men, and that is making sense. So two vice presidents and a commissioner for the digital agenda. So not bad, and we still should be very alert how they are doing. And I'm pleased that nearby 50% of this audience is female, for that is normal, so to say. Having said that, just jumping to one of the remarks you were making, Karen, it is indeed quite clear how the mood of quite a number of European people is talking about privacy, talking about data protection, and so on, of course. But also be quite relative in judging what is at stake. For all those Europeans, I can assure you, are using all the devices, but are also showing a behaving. They put everything on every mean. So sometimes you should also be relative in what is at stake. By the way, I don't dare to say, for that would be absolutely not the truth, that it isn't a serious issue, and therefore I'm so delighted that we can discuss it in a very friendly and open way, Kathy, her services, and other parts of the US government. We need to tackle it, no doubt about that, but we should also be realistic and not exaggerate, for that is never the way you can solve problems. If we are talking about the relationship between the US and the EU, and it's not from today, it is already a long-standing line, and when you were mentioning that the Marshall name is still recognized, but then my age is already counting again. After World War II, we are still grateful for your Marshall help at that time, for it was the boost for a recovery of Europe. And by the way, and then I will be back to the real subject, if we are that part in our history, and also a little bit later, also when I was a Dutch minister attending councils in Brussels, when you would have mentioned at that time that we are with 28 member states at the moment, that we do have a single market, by the way, not finalized, and one idiot issue, the telco sector is not included in the digital single market, so I won't leave before I have my telco single market proposal accepted. Anyhow, one fan. And besides that, a euro that in quite a number of those 28 member states is the coin. And if you would have added at that time in the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s, that I would be for the second term commissioner of the European Commission, I would have sent you to a psychiatric hospital. And I had good relationships, for I had been a president of a psychiatric hospital, so it was absolutely not thinkable at that time. Europe, the continent, was divided. It was apart the communist a system with walls, the Berlin Wall, and so on and so forth, and some other member states with a military dictatorship, so Greece, Spain, Portugal. So can you imagine when we are gathering in the Commission's weekly meeting that sometimes I have the thought, looking around with 28 colleagues, that quite a number of them do have experience, not only as a very young, but not even a bit older, that they do have experience in complete different approaches. No democracy, no values that we are so proud of and that is connecting with relationship with the US. Then it is a miracle what is happening. But it's often with miracles. They won't stand if you are not working on it. And that, for me, is main also talking about the digital single market. It is absolutely, well, looking and just mentioning 1989, so not that long ago, the fall of the Berlin Wall, but that was also the fall of the wall where we were communicating. That was the start of the internet, 89, two tremendous, important occasions where we were faced with, now it's up to us, taking all the opportunities in those falling downs of walls. And that, again, is a opportunity, and more than an opportunity, not only to publish reports and to make nice statements and so on, but to follow up and making it an other way of thinking, out of the box, other mindset, you name it. But it's not anymore, are you in favor for a digital market? It is a fact. So now, politicians, but everybody, academic people, every business people, everyone is faced with a situation. Fact, it's there. What can we do with it, and how can we use it, and how can we make it a opportunity and a challenge for everybody? And that is main for me from day one on that I got this portfolio. Don't make a device in a population. Don't make it for the happy few and the not. It is for everybody. And therefore, my first line in office was every European digital. Well, I can assure you that some of my very bright and smart collaborators were saying, Neelie, come on, you're taking a risk. You can't fulfill that. And I said, well, I'm Dutch. I'm not a diplomat. And I want to be clear. And I want to be indeed in a position where people can say, we believe you. And not, then you will be fired. Okay, that's the risk of the game. So opportunities of the new technology, not for the happy few, but for everybody. And that is my fight within, and I am sure that you recognize it, Cathy, where I have to deal with all the ministers of the 28 member states that are involved. And by the way, all the ministers are involved, for it's not anymore, it's just one sector. It is what I always say, a horizontal portfolio. It's connected with energy, it's connected with education, it's connected with culture, with economy, health, you name it. And everybody can get an advantage. And if you are not joining the party, then you are not only getting no advantages, but you are getting the disadvantages of not having that opportunity. So the technological advances and the development of the internet economy is main. And then I'm coming to my next very important but open door for you statement. It is not anymore a ring fence situation. It's not talking about member states or a country, or it's not talking about the European Union. It's talking about a global theme. It is completely without borders, without barriers. And what is now the big issue? How artificial are we acting when we say, and still, so I'm against protectionism. We have to protect, of course, the consumers. We have to protect the citizens. And therefore, I always say, in itself, and I know that some of my people will say, oh, spying is what I have said before. It is one of those professions that are nearby the second eldest on the world. And I always add to that, and if you are combining it with the first profession, the eldest, then it is great. Then there we have in Europe, anyhow, a couple of historical figures, so to say. But don't be naive, and don't think that we are all angels, and don't think. But, and that is what we are discussing, and what our governments are discussing, there are limitations in that type of behaving, and there are limitations certainly when you are talking about a friendly relationship, but also that we have to be alert if we are not tackling this problem, and if we are not at the same page talking about, for example, and rightly said so, the safe harbor and so on, if we can't deal with it, then we are missing absolutely a big opportunity. And there are others in the world who are from a different religion, so to say, from a different thought about democracy, from a different way of making it connected with values, with freedom of press, freedom of speech, and also very open. It is a daily fight, also within the European family, for not everybody within the European family is also behaving conform. We are just looking at other ones. Well, I don't need to be more clear, but it's unacceptable. So if you are preaching, then you should indeed fill in. So I put aside the recent revelations about mass surveillance and recent examples of internet fraud, hackling, and cybercrime. We are aware that we have to come together, and not only come together, for that's always a pleasure, but that we really make a step forward. By the way, I need it that we just solve those type of problems. Why? Connecting it with my first line, every European digital. In Europe, in certain member states, there are still quite a number of people who never ever visited internet. And I'm not stating that is just because those people are doing other things. No, I'm saying in most cases it's all because they don't trust internet, or that they are not aware what they are missing. And of course, both parts need to be explained and need to be taken care of, and therefore trust, for me, is one of the main issues. If there is no trust and trustworthy systems, then you can't expect that all those people are coming to the internet. And why is that needed? Well, of course, because I'm absolutely aware that it is positive for everybody, and up to them if they use it often, not often, or whatever. But also for governments, for talking about health systems, we have to be aware that with, anyhow, talking about Europe, the absolutely outrageous rising of cost of health, an aging population, really aging, and that can be great, but with the cost in the health services, it has a consequence. If you can solve that through digitization, then it would make a lot of sense. And what I was mentioning yesterday to Kathy, my big hero in Europe is a 94-year-old woman living in Rome, a writer, and she writes blogs, and it's absolutely fascinating. And she is a part of a research project talking about robotics. And she is mentioning, and I think that is the best you can just explain what's all about, she is mentioning to the outside world, if I wouldn't have had a robot in my house, I wouldn't be anymore independently in my living. I would have to go to an elderly home or whatever. And she said, for me, it's so important to have my independency, and therefore I'm creative in my writing. And then you can see that she is main in that research project, for she is teaching the researchers that's not doing the job that you think, and so on and so forth. It is also a part, and if you allow me to say so, some people are asking me, what is your real worry at the moment? Well, of course, the stability in that part of Europe where was touched upon earlier, and not only in Europe, but for me, a real issue is the youth unemployment. If we are looking at some of the figures in some member states, it's absolutely unacceptable, the level of unemployed youngsters. And I'm not talking about unemployed and please keep hope, next year you will find your job. No hope for a job at all. So then you are talking about a lost generation. And a lost generation, for me, is an attack on your democracy. For you can wait and you can see it in the history, but you can see it right now. Those people don't trust politicians, don't trust systems, and so on. There is a positive part, and there I'm again such a fan of the digital development and the digital single market and the transatlantic digital single market. For innovation and innovators are nurtured by that development. And those youngsters, they are smart. They are not waiting till politicians are offering them more perspective in life. They are just doing the job. The app developers at the moment in Europe are sky high. The number is raising. And don't misunderstand me, it's not always every app developer, big success and so on. But quite a number is very successful. By the way, that also gives me the hook to say that is what I am admiring in your society, Kathy, that people are not only used to failures and accepting failures, but it is a must. If you don't have failures in your life, then you didn't take enough risks. And that is a part of the explanation what is happening here. So we in Europe have to change that mindset too. Many values between us, fundamentally, absolutely a learning curve. But this is one of the learning curves, anyhow, for me. And therefore, an open exchange of ideas is at stake. And therefore, it's not only talking about how can we remove trade barriers and how can we remove tariffs. It is about, indeed, making it happen. We can work together in so many areas, and we can both enjoy the digital boost, and we can, indeed, the online transactions pushing, make it a bit more safe, making it a bit more trustworthy, and then it is going to happen. Last remark on the digital single market and that phenomenon that the telco sector is not included in the single market. It is, again, odd and you can't understand it. So this proposal will tackle roaming. That, of course, is making a lot of sense for the citizens, for it is a billing system that is not anymore based on reality. It's based on the past. So when you are passing a border from former times, you recognize it because you get a beep on your mobile, but there is no border anymore. So, I don't need to explain that. It is talking about spectrum, quite a sensitive issue, and normally spoken you would say, sensitive, come on. It is a challenge to make it more efficient and to make it more effective, but governments and especially ministers of finance are earning a lot of money out of the auctions of spectrum. So we have to push that, and of course net neutrality. Well, that is also well known in the US. I sincerely hope that we are making it. So far Parliament is backing us, and not everyone in Parliament, of course not, but then I would say if everyone would back my proposal, then I haven't made a good proposal. So this is something where we can really show that it makes sense. And of course, consumer protection, and that is a very important one because you need absolutely the certainty that people are aware what they are paying. And my last line, for example, about net neutrality, if you can be blocked and if you can be throttled in your connection, that is not giving you a good feeling about the treatment that you are paying for. And you are paying for something that is not blocking and not throttling. And indeed, it's open in the internet for everybody. By the way, also taking into account that the businesses, and now I'm talking about the telco sector, they have to change their mindset to get in a more healthy approach of their doing business. That also means that they have to get opportunities and challenges in making products available that people are interested in, and by the way, is a push for investing in high-speed broadband. And I'm always surprised, and that is really something that we need to push. If we are looking at Korea, if we are looking at the People's Republic of China, well, People's Republic of China can just take a decision and say, now you are not eating rice, but you are just taking high-speed broadband. That is a bit different from our approach. But still, we need to invest in not only our future, but in this afternoon, so to say. For those people who really are waiting for it, they deserve that we are doing our job. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think we can all see why it's taking three men to replace this vice president. So please, Undersecretary Novelli, please go ahead.
Well, it's always hard to go last because everybody has made so many points, and I think we're in violent agreement here. And first, I just want to thank PPI for hosting this along with the Lisbon Council. I want to thank Georgetown University, the German Marshall Fund, and mostly I just want to say to Neelie, thank you for your leadership. And I know that you're going to continue to lead, and we need you. So it has been a pleasure to know you in my private life and in my public life, and I think Europe is very lucky that they've had you to guide them through this. I also want to thank PPI for what they've done to try to put facts around the internet economy. Because I think a lot of the discussion that we've been having is politicians and policymakers, we say a lot of things, but I think one of the most important things that we have to do is ground what we do in facts. And one, it is a fact that a thriving transatlantic digital economy is critical to economic growth and shared prosperity. And so I just thought I could give you some statistics that certainly blew my mind. Maybe they're well known to you, but we expect by 2016 that the global digital economy taken as a whole will equate to the fifth largest economy in the world. And it will contribute $4.2 trillion just to the G20's collective gross domestic product. I mean, that is just gigantic. And as Neelie said, it's not something we can ignore, and we shouldn't ignore it. But we also, I believe, very strongly have to protect it. And not in a protectionist way either. Europe is by far the United States' largest source of and destination for digitally delivered cross-border services. And so by next year, we expect internet services in the U.S. and the EU to generate $323 billion in consumer benefits. So if you think about from when the internet started to now, we don't have an evolution, we have a revolution. And developed markets, the internet is contributing 5 to 9% of total GDP. Developing markets, it is growing at 15 to 25% a year. And we know that this has an impact on all sectors of the economy. It's an incredible opportunity. And I think, you know, we have to keep ourselves focused on that because it's certainly much more interesting to read about everybody arguing about things. But the truth is, we all want to have economic prosperity, and this is vital to that. And so here's a couple of examples just to make this real. Coursera, a free education service that offers courses online from top universities and organizations worldwide. So this little site has more than 9 million, 65% of which are outside of the United States. Estonia, one of the most open internet sectors in the world. No big surprise that the country leads the globe in startups per capita. So entrepreneurs there can set up a company in 15 minutes, and there's a huge result from that. Medicine, located in Finland, provides e-health solutions like remote home monitoring and advanced patient portals in Europe, Asia, and the United States, and it won the European Union's small and medium enterprise e-health competition. So these very tangible things they're everywhere in the globe, and you can find these examples everywhere. And so what we in the United States, and we're working together with Europe, and I think there's absolutely no transatlantic divide on these things, is we are in violent agreement that we need to promote global policies and practices that increase everybody's access to broadband globally. And the second thing is that we need to strengthen the ability of citizens to access information on the internet regardless of where they live. And we know that that is not something that every country in the world agrees to. And we have to work together ourselves in Europe to put that forward. And then the third thing, and this goes to the controversy part, there has been misuse of the internet. And I think we have to admit that. And those of us who, you know, are perhaps a bit libertarian about governance of the internet, I think we all have to admit that that there have been some issues. Cyber attacks, identity theft, child pornography, there are some issues. And we need to work collectively to address those. And to me, it is extremely important that all stakeholders in the internet work on that. Personally, and as the policy of the United States, we believe that governance of the internet should be done through the multi-stakeholder system. And there have been a lot of voices saying, no, governments need to take over, multilateral institutions need to take over. But if you think about it, and you think about the efficiency of the internet and what we all have come to take for granted, would you really want a large multilateral institution trying to regulate that on a day-to-day basis? You know, this is the type of thing where we do have to pay attention, or we're going to find ourselves in a very different world than we're in today. So these stakeholders, and including them all in the conversation, we think that's the best way to support innovation and growth, and also to develop ways to make the online environment more secure. And I think we and our European friends and allies absolutely agree that we need to do this, and that we need to work together to promote this multi-stakeholder way of internet governance. We also have a long history of working together as partners to make sure that data can be transferred transatlantically across borders. And the safe harbor mechanism is, to me, a great example of how Europe had a different system than the US, but we managed to find a way to allow our economies to continue to function in an efficient way. And since then, there's 3,500 organizations across a broad range of industries that are safe harbor certified, and the FTC has been very, very vigorous in enforcing the safe harbor rules so that they can have credibility and that whole process can have credibility. And one of the things I think we forget, because these folks aren't in the news, is who's using this safe harbor. Well, 60% of the companies that use safe harbor are small and medium enterprises. Backbones of economy in the United States, in Europe, and everywhere else. So to me, you know, we need to focus on the fact that this safe harbor has been in effect for many, many years. And we are working, as Neelie said, to make sure that it continues further. And yes, we have some things that we need to work out, but we in the US, and I know in the EU, are committed to finding a way through this and to keep the safe harbor functional and effective, so that we can preserve this continued flow of data and all this economic opportunity that continues. Similarly, I think we have an incredible opportunity with TTIP. And in TTIP, I think there's a couple things. One is, we already agree on a lot of things, and we already have, if we take the 50,000 foot view and not the 5,000 or 500 foot view, we already have pretty good practices on both sides. And so part of what TTIP is how do we lock in those good things as a gold standard so that we can show the world what the gold standard is. And those are simple things, like saying we're not going to discriminate against products that are digitally transmitted, and we're not going to charge tariffs just because you're doing something digitally. and we're going to allow, you know, digital signatures and all kinds of things that we're already doing. But it's very important, and I don't think we should underestimate the value of locking that in and kind of making a public statement as well to the world that this is where we stand on this. And that's why I think it is so important that we continue to work together. And we have to work through these issues that everybody has talked about, and we absolutely do. But I think we have to do that with a sense of about what really is at stake here in our relationship, in our economies, and that we want to preserve and grow those things. Because the fact is that we and the EU have shared values of openness, free expression, and commercial opportunity for all. And so our task really now is to work together to make sure that we can keep the internet open, inclusive, and secure and on a global basis, because that is where the real threat is coming from. And I would like to look at the positive side and believe that those governments that are advocating for this kind of heavy-handed government role perhaps don't have a complete understanding of what's going on in their economies that is benefiting from this. And I think we have, everybody in this room, has an absolute obligation to start communicating that through every layer of society and through all of their connections, because this is something much bigger than just governments. And we need to keep it open, and we need to keep it available for everybody. Thank you.
Well, that was a very compelling call for the open internet, so thank you so much. And I now am just going to ask a couple of questions of our speakers, and then I'm going to open it up to all of you. Vice President Kroes, let me start with you. I saw an article recently that talked about a study that Accenture had done. And it said the vast majority of European business leaders see digital technologies as important to improving Europeans' competitiveness and economic growth, right? The purpose of this conference. But one half believe that Europe will lag behind both the United States and China in the development of digital technologies over the next 3 years. And I read that and thought about a comment that you've made before, in the wake of the Snowden disclosures, where you made this point that Europe could make stronger standards for data protection and security a source of comparative advantage in digital competition with the US. And you married that statement by also saying, I don't want to build walls. So I'm saying yes to protection, but no to protectionism. And I wanted to ask you how you thread that needle.
It's a good conclusion for a couple of my thoughts in this field. And it is a fact that quite a number of European entrepreneurs are thinking that there will be a bigger gap between the positioning of US and other parts of the globe and the European position of the industry. I always say, okay, so be it, shall we act? For then you need to act. And what is fascinating, and certainly talking about security, and certainly talking about the position of a couple of industries still in the number one position all over the globe, so talking about robotics, talking about semiconductors, and producing of chips and so on. So use that position and just build it out. And if we are highly interested in security, and so is the US, and so is, but we do have quite a couple of very strong opportunities to make it a export product. Mm-hmm. And I'm always saying, if you are not only believing that it is so important, but that you can prove it, prove it. And what was said by Kathy, talking about, for example, Estonia and Finland in certain areas, you can prove it as an example of just filling that gap. Another issue is that the European Union is quite pushy in creating partnerships talking about research and innovation. And sometimes we are too modest. Normally spoken, that is not very obvious, but sometimes we are. And if I'm looking what is happening, not only with startups, and sometimes they're leaving Europe and they are going, but quite often there are always, there are also people from outside Europe coming in with their startups and their successes, and especially talking about the security field. So in those public-private partnerships, we are, for example, talking about cloud. We are pushing with a bit of money, and Horizon 2020 is giving opportunities for those money in injections, then we can indeed make a step forward instead of just making the conclusion we are lacking behind. I only say lacking behind means be more inspired and be more motivated to take the lead. And we are trying to help those issues. By the way, and that's my last part of the answer, in Europe it's still quite often, and I'm not certain if that's the same in the US, that a couple of industries sitting together is one, but making them in the mood that it is cooperating when they are in a way competitors, but when they are doing it together, then it's even more than one plus one, then it's not two. And I'm always saying it should be like at that time the Airbus project. The Airbus project was a combination. So if it is an Airbus project of chips, for example, of chip producers, then at the end of the day, we are having a better position for a global fight and positive fight of our position.
Well, thank you very much for that. Undersecretary Novelli, I was struck by your comment about TTIP. And, you know, sort of saying, look, we should, in a sense, codify what we're already doing, create this gold standard, have that be a platform for also the rest of the world. And I wanted to draw you out on that and ask if that's a call for a specific chapter on the digital economy in the ongoing negotiations on TTIP, or just tell me where you're leading us with that.
Frankly, I don't know that it matters if there's a chapter or not a chapter. It just matters what's in the agreement. And so I don't think we should. There's lots of controversy around all kinds of chapters, and should there be a chapter on this or that or the other thing? And to me, the importance is what's the substance, not whether it's in a chapter or not. And I think we need to think about how do we codify, and then how do we move forward with some cutting edge things that where we can both agree and where we both see the need to push everybody else? And that's what we should be thinking about when we're thinking about this space.
Mm-hmm. And what specific components would you see to those digital measures?
I've outlined a couple already. I'm not the lead negotiator of the TTIP, so I don't want Mike Froman calling me up, and, you know. But I do think we clearly share this view of that internet governance should be something that's multi-stakeholder, and I think we need to find some way that we enshrine that, whether that's in TTIP or something else, because there are a lot of forces. There's a vote coming up. Just at the end of October in Korea, in the context of the ITU plenipotentiary, that would say no, sorry, the UN's taking this over. So I mean, this is not something I'm making up. This is a real and present issue, and so I think it's something that we have to be cognizant of, and we have to be clear that we agree, which we do, that isn't the way to go.
Terrific. And I'm very mindful of the fact that Undersecretary Novelli has been terrific in participating this morning because she wanted so much to be here. She does have a hard stop at 10:15, so I do want to open it up to all of you. And I'd encourage folks who have questions for Undersecretary Novelli to sort of come first. And Vice President Kroes has offered to stay a little bit beyond that. So I saw your hand first. Is this for the Undersecretary?
It's
for both. Okay. Okay.
for which I just completed a report on trade policy and internet, in which I think for open internet, very strong areas. I have two questions.
And number one is, I think, Karen, you mentioned that European Commission was going after a number of American actors of the internet. But I think there are real competition issues that these companies have faced also in this country. And given the very strong background of Commissioner Kroes in the competition issues, I would like to ask actually both panelists if they don't think that there should be tries to develop common approaches on abuses of dominance by some of these companies. And the second one about free internet. There has been a vote 2 days ago in the French parliament that actually allows the government to try to ban access to jihadist sites which recruit. There are about 900 young French people today in Syria and Iraq. And I must say, it's very hard to get a religion on that. I would like to ask the advice of the two panelists on whether we should indeed try to ban access to those sites or not. Because it's a question I myself have a hard time to answer.
Okay.
Well, I'm sitting next to the expert on competition, so I, but I would say, I mean, I think we have slightly different systems on competition. And so, and those are gonna continue. And these, some of these questions have already been looked at in our system. They're being looked at or have been looked at in Europe and will continue to be. And I have no doubt that we're gonna continue to look at these, whether we, I don't think it's probably practical to say that we're gonna jointly make decisions on something like that just because our systems are different. I think your last question is, I don't know the answer to it either. I think it is an incredibly difficult question. And it, at least in our country, you know, the First Amendment has been strong. And this is a question that isn't just about the internet. It's about free speech and what is it that you control. And I think different countries can legitimately draw lines in slightly different places. I mean, the fact is, you know, we've said you can't yell fire in a crowded theater. You know, we've said, you know, that pornography is a place where we draw a line. So it's not to say that everything, no matter what, is always fine. But I mean, these are topics that we all have to wrestle with, and I think we have to wrestle with them understanding that we don't want to go so far down a slippery slope that we are in danger of limiting access to legitimate information. And so I think drawing those lines is incredibly difficult, and I think they have to be answered within each society and how they make those decisions. I'm not meaning to condone censorship in any way, because I think that is just way too far, and I think we can agree way too far on the other side. But there is a small area over here where I think everybody agrees that some things are just not, from a societal perspective, child pornography is not okay. So, you know, it's sort of, that's a place, where do you put that, you know, on this, in this small group or in the larger group of free flow of information? Mm-hmm. And it is an incredibly difficult question.
Mm-hmm. Starting with the first one, and it seems to be rather easy to just join Cathy's answer. Our competition policy is a bit different, to put it in a nice way. The markets are different, and especially talking about the telco sector, where talking about the numbers and how it's organized. But out of experience, we do have absolutely a very good cooperation on a daily basis during my term in office, and I can't imagine that that has been changed. There is contact between the two competition authorities and is keeping informed and is indeed feeding each other and so on, sitting together. So that is no point. And you can have a different system, so come on. But it all starts with infringements. If you do have the feeding, and talking about our system, infringements are quite often based on complaints of certain parties. And I'm always the one who is saying, competition policy for me is to protect consumers, that at the end of the day they get a quality and innovative product for a decent price. It's not for protecting competitors, for that is a that's a different story. And sometimes others are mixing that up. So far I think we are well aware what's going on both sides. And sometimes it is mixed up. For it's quite easy talking about, if you don't mind, to touch upon what is the reality, the Google issue. A lot of people in a lot of member states are aware that it is unfair because they are not paying tax, or that they are paying not enough tax, or and so on and so forth. And there they are saying you should tackle for them the Google issue, the competition issue is the tax issue. And I always say, shall we start with, it's not Google tax, it is talking about the tax system in general, and quite willing to discuss that, but then not only focusing it on one issue. And by the way, for I had quite a number of that type of meetings with telco CEOs, and they were always complaining, but you are getting used to that. So, and when I confront them with my question and saying, if you are so worried that Google is not paying and that you are investing, why aren't you billing them? And then they say, yeah, but the consumer doesn't like that. And I said, come on, so now you are asking me to take a measure where you are not willing to take the consequences. Well, but there is a general attitude that we have to discuss, but then in far broader sense, the issues. I hesitate, like Kathy is hesitating, about your second point, and you are hesitating in finding a point. I think we all three are on the same page. For me, and with children pornography, for sometimes I'm just faced with my political background, and that's well known in the European Parliament, and they are saying you are liberal, but in the US I have to explain that it is different liberal than being a member of a liberal party than in Europe. But anyhow, I am for free flow and so on and so forth. But there is one sector where I'm absolutely dominant, and whatever people are calling me, and that's child pornography. I think that it is absolutely unacceptable what is happening there. It is for some people making big money and so on. And by the way, cooperation between the US and Europe is extremely good. And we had an awful case in the Netherlands at that time, thanks to the US political policy, people who were involved in finding out how we could just enroll it. So that for me is free or not free, but that is absolutely. We have to educate too. For we have to educate the parents talking about child pornography more. It isn't the solution, but we need to do that too. Your point, and I was expecting that, for that is my big question that I can't answer at the moment. Those awful clips about what did happen in the Middle East with two US citizens and a UK citizen, and they are asking for publicity. So are we serving them, yes or no? So that for me is such a matter of what is the purpose that you try to deal. I don't know the answer, the arguments for both sides. Still not an answer on your point. there will be a moment for it's not only the numbers of French youngsters that are leaving, but also in other parts. So far too many are going there, and sometimes 11-year-old people, girls too, so not only boys. So it is typically one of those consequences of getting a open information, open, but very well structured and conducted by those idiots. But having said that, it is difficult to say here is, but there will be a moment for this can't go on, in my opinion.
I'm going to take one last question. Your hand was one I saw in the back, and then we will release the undersecretary.
Thank you very much. Tanase from MSF Estonia, or sometimes we say Estonia. I'm very glad that actually one of these three men will be Estonian, replacing your vice president. But I have a question about the recent ideas and proposals of two-speed internet. And how do you see about the principles of competition in this sense? And I'm just wondering if these ideas are right now here, if they will be soon also in Europe, in the sense that if we talk about the principles of internet for everybody, and in Estonia has high-speed internet, it's almost like a human right, then that creates a bit of worries. Thank you.
Well, so I think he's talking about the net neutrality suggestions proposal that was put forward by the Federal Communications Commission. And what I would say is President Obama and the administration have stood for net neutrality from day one, and we continue to stand for that very strongly. The FCC has put out a request for comments, and in the history of all requests for comments, which is our system, having notice and comment regulation, they've received 3 million comments. It's more than any other regulation has ever received, and I think that's great. And I think there's always folks who have clever business models and want to do innovation. And I think net neutrality and protecting it is something that deserves 3 million comments worth of discourse. And the FCC is going to sift through those. And I think the chairman of the FCC has made a number of statements since the original proposal to try to clarify what he meant. I don't think even he meant that there should be a two-speed internet. That's sort of what got taken by the press and moved forward, and that is not what he was discussing. So this whole process is going to go on, and I can't speak for the FCC because they're an independent regulatory agency, but I can say that I think the principle of net neutrality is something that is absolutely embedded in this country. And so we will see exactly how the needle is threaded by the FCC chairman, but we have been stalwart on the net neutrality side.
I absolutely know everyone wants to hear your views on this too, but I'm just going to do a little brief interlude for all of us to thank Undersecretary Novelli for joining us. Please.
A bit the same line. It's not talking about two-speed internet. The proposal that is at the table now is absolutely open internet for everybody. No blocking, no throttling. So that already is a huge step forward, for we all have experiences that we are blocked or throttled. And that is giving opportunities to those who are really very much linked with guarantee that it is a quality internet. Having said that, and that was in the total package, there are certain services that are asking for more quality. For example, in the e-health, connecting hospitals, where one hospital is even better in certain disciplines and certain. And if there is a operation and there is online connection with another one who has more experience or whatever, then it would be, of course, nobody neglected that the highest quality is at stake. So for those services, it is allowed to have, as long as it is not damaging the open internet for everybody. It is also talking about startups. Startups could at a certain moment say, I will pay for absolutely the highest quality that is available because my invention is so connected with that quality. So it is giving the businesses a opportunity to develop products where they can make money out of. And then, and that is a nice experience for, I didn't expect that I would get so quick a example, the agreement between Netflix and Deutsche Telco is showing that they are willing to pay. Deutsche is interested in making such a deal. And of course, because they are aware that the regulator that we will give it a very clear eye if they are not touching upon that open internet for everybody, they will invest. And that was the announcement of the CEO. These are the stimulances for us to invest more in broadband. And that is what I really am interested in. So then you catch with one stone more birds, so to say. So it's not a matter of different treatments. Absolutely safe, no blocking, no throttling, open internet, everybody. And I think that's so. And by the way, it is also a matter of why should you not give opportunities to certain startups too? And certain and other startups don't need it. And say we stick in that line of still good quality of open internet. Mm.
Super. Yeah, please, the gentleman in the blue jacket I had seen early on.
Brian Beery, Washington correspondent, Europolitics. Question on cloud computing services. In the wake of the NSA revelations, there's been some talk about whether Europe, in response to that, should have its own sort of segmented cloud computing industry. And just wondering what your thoughts on that are.
I recognize at that moment the thoughts in having an own cloud, and I was one of them who was mentioning that to the outside world too. So is this the moment that we have to be more aware that we should develop something like that too? Anyhow, you don't need a European cloud, and that is ring-fenced and so on, but you need to be aware that within the systems, and that is where we have to discuss the issues too, that it's not because at the end of the day the cloud is located somewhere in this part of the world, and therefore you need to fulfill all the regulations that are at stake. And there is the sensitivity between the two issues. So what we are talking, and President Ilves was the chair of that cloud report, and with the cloud producers and users in Europe, is giving a couple of advices that are very workable and very advisable to follow up.
Mm-hmm. And I've been told there can only be one last question, and it'll go over to this side.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your remarks. As you know, Commissioner, ICANN features in the internet governance debate that's going on.
And my question to you. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Pardon me? David McCauley, sorry. It's David McCauley with Bloomberg BNA. And I want to ask about a factual question in which the multi-stakeholder model at ICANN is being tested with government interests. And it has to do with applications for .one. It looks like that decision has been made and the applications are moving forward. Irrespective of European concerns, what is left for you or for the European Union to do? Are there any avenues available in that particular case, or is the issue over, done and dusted? Thank you.
No, certainly not. For when a decision is idiot, you are not forced to stay forever with idiot decisions. And this one is not linked with reality. And by the way, it was not only the wine producers in Europe, also the wine producers in the US were on our side. So the California wine producers were on the same page, so to say. But what is at stake with ICAN? And for me, also with the decision that the US government has made at the beginning of this year, talking about IANA for its ICAN, IANA and the GAC. We need systems that are accountable and that are transparent and that I really love in the statement of Kathy that it is not needed to, she wasn't saying that my wording, we don't need sexy organizations. Come on, it should be a very decent, well accountable and well transparent organization that is taking care of what is at stake, the domain names and so on, and talk. And what I'm worried about, that and with all respect of technicians, for I do have a lot of technicians in my staff and I couldn't function without them, but at the end of the day, it is a political decision, and they, what the GAC did, is, and taking so much time, I thought at a certain moment, they are believing in eternal life. Well, I'm not. So talking about, for example, .eu in the Greek language, still not a decision. Can you imagine what I had to explain to Greek people who are saying, by the way, our language is a little bit older than the English language or the American language. Are we allowed to use that? Okay, so for me, in this case, I'm absolutely pleading for a far more efficient and effective system, multi-stakeholder. For that is the risk where, if we are not acting, what could be the consequence? For there are other parts of the world that are in favor for governmental approaches and not multi-stakeholder, just governments, People's Republic of China, Russia, a couple of other ones. Having said that, then we should be aware that it is hooked with the UN, and I'm completely aware how important the UN can be, but to say that it is a Speedy Gonzales atmosphere over there, that's not completely. And we need with this technology such a link to reality and to what is happening, not somewhere outrageous and so on, what's happening every day for people to function in the right way. So I think we are, time is not on our side. We need to make clear what type of multifunctional model, and we need to be aware that we have to make it visible. For in this case, it's not enough to say we are both for a multi-stakeholders model, now implementation and now right on that spot.
Well, before we go to the coffee break, I would just want to ask you all to join me in thanking Vice President Kroes, not... I'm just going to finish the thought, not just for this morning, but for all she has done in her time as Vice President and Commissioner. She has always said what she thinks, she has remained true to her values and principles, and she's made a real difference and contribution on issues of great policy significance. So for that also, please join me in thanking her.
Let's also thank Karen for very ably steering this great conversation. Folks, we can't bring coffee in here, so we're going to have a 10-minute coffee break. So please get coffee, but be back in 10 minutes. We're going to have a terrific panel that'll drill deeper into some of the sticking points and talk about where we might find common ground.
Okay, thank you. I think we're about to begin with the second session. I hope there was time for everyone to get some coffee. It looked a little bit like a camel going through the eye of a needle out there, and I can only apologize that perhaps demand was greater than the ability of supply to meet it. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Paul Hoffines. I'm president of the Lisbon Council. And before we get started, even though they've already left, I'd just like to thank our panelists in the previous session who were absolutely terrific, both as they were praised on numerous occasions for all of the important public policy work they do, but for taking so much time to be with us here this morning and share their views on things. Can we have a quick round of applause for the previous panel? By way of inspiring the panel that
it's going to be a hard act to follow.
Okay, good. One of the very good friends of the Lisbon Council, some of you may know Don Tapscott, a great thinker on the internet economy, who was doing this before. It was cool, actually. I think Don's first book came out about 25 years ago and is about to be reissued. One of the things Don likes to talk about is how the internet is changing democracy. The way he puts it was, in the past, the paradigm used to be, you vote, we govern. And that's no longer the case. The people who vote are much more involved at a frontline level on policy and the way it comes out. I was struck in particular by Kathy Novelli's statistic that the FCC submission or proposal on net neutrality had received 3 million comments. The reason I'm mentioning all this is very much the spirit in which I would like to conduct this panel. In the past, panels were we speak, you listen. This is meant to be an interactive session, and we are very much would love to hear what's on your mind, both in the form of questions, but also in the forms of comments. And hopefully the formal presentations won't go on too long, so it won't simply be you vote, we govern, but let's all govern together. And let's all speak out loud and reflect out loud on the very real challenges that we'll be discussing here. We do have a very distinguished panel, and I'd like to put four questions to each of them, although they're essentially the same question. What is the potential? What are the risks? What do we need to do about it? And the fourth thing is the emphasis on we. And by we, I mean, of course, each and every one of us in this room today. Because frankly, we are a part of the solution. It's not just Kathy Novelli and Neelie Kroes who's going to solve this. The solution in some fundamental ways will come out of dialogue that is taking place in rooms like this one today. On that note, let me pass the floor over to my friend and colleague, Mike Mandel. For those of you who missed it, a moment of blatant self-promotion, Mike and I published a paper in the spring on the data-driven economy, which I believe he's going to talk about in this morning, updating the numbers and taking us further down the road, as he so often does. We appreciate your leadership in this area too, Mike. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Paul. I'm extremely happy to be here this morning. It was great listening to the Kathy Novelli and Neelie Kroes this morning talk about these essential issues. First, in terms of democracy, of course, there's a very active Twitter conversation going on at this point, if anybody wants to participate. I'm not one of those people who is capable of talking and Twittering at the same time, but I've seen that, and I'm really terribly impressed by it. The other element of democracy is, I really shouldn't even say this, but if you look at the pictures in the program, you'll see that I don't have facial hair in the picture there. And I've been sort of, this is relatively new, and so I've been asking people what their opinions are. So if we really want to go to democracy, we can sort of bring it that far. So far, the opinions seem to be positive, but not everybody. We have the transatlantic digital economy here. And part of the point that I want to make, and it's a really important point, is that it's not just about trade. And what I want to introduce here is the broader concept of connectedness. Connectedness is a concept that includes trade, but goes far beyond that. It includes connections between people, that is personal connections and business connections. It includes cross-border data flows, which are very often not picked up in the trade statistics, and this is some of the work that PPI has done. It includes movements of people, immigrants, and also business people, so you can have a community, cross-border community of legal, marketing, accounting, sort of firms that are continually passing people back and forth between countries. So this notion of connectedness is a much broader concept than trade. And I actually think when we take a step back, it's going to turn out that global connectedness is in fact the key to prosperity, that we have to take a step back and not focus so narrowly on trade flows. Countries, regions, and cities that are connected end up doing better than ones that are disconnected, because you get to participate in the global growth, you get to participate in the global flow of intangibles, you get to participate in the cross-border data flows. Now, this is an area where language is really important. We usually talk about globalization. Globalization has turned out to be about, I mean, it didn't start out that way, globalization has turned out to be about competitiveness. You're globalized, you're competing with other countries, other parts of the world. I think we switched to talking about connectedness, which is about cooperation, it's about participation in the growth of other parts of the world. In the case of the transatlantic digital economy, connectedness is about growing together. And we need to move away from exports good, imports bad. So, you know, Paul mentioned that he and I did a paper today on the sort of earlier this year on the data gap. It was available outside. We've updated some of the numbers on this. And the reason why we're bringing this here, you know, these are not your usual trade statistics. They don't tell you exports. They don't tell you imports. Data is not about that. Connections are not about exports and imports. It's about growing together. It's about being able to exchange good ideas. It's about being able to exchange good opportunities. And the more connectedness you have, the better off that you have. And for those of you who have the updated chart in front of you, I'm going to sort of talk a little bit about that, because this is an important issue when we think about which countries are well situated for the future. So we did, using data that Cisco on the data flows by country, looked at per capita data flows, both and also for businesses. And what we found out is that with hardly any exceptions, that most of Europe is lagging behind the US, Canada, Korea in this kind of connectedness. This is not exports, this is not imports, this is a different measure here. So up at the top, we've got South Korea with almost 66 gigabytes per month of per capita usage of data. Close behind is United States at 58.3, Canada, Sweden, and the UK. What's interesting here is that France and Germany are down roughly at about one-third of the US in terms of per capita usage of data. Now, what can we take from this? We can take from this that the connectedness in these countries, at least on this dimension, is less than in the US. Part of the debate for the transatlantic digital economy is just how much connectedness is good. We'd like to advocate that, as a rule, more connectedness is better, leads to greater prosperity, leads to greater creation of wealth, not just for the countries that are participating, but for everybody. And on that note, I think I'll sort of sit down and turn it over to the next speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you.
In my haste to get the panel started, I neglected to introduce Michael properly. He's, of course, the chief economic strategist of the Progressive Policy Institute. And Larry Downs, our next speaker, thank you so much for hosting us here today. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here on your turf. I cannot, well, first of all, I should introduce you properly, the director of the Center for Business and Public Policy at Georgetown. I was hoping to put in a word for your book, which ordinarily I would hold up right about now, but I can't do that, though you did very cleverly put the cover on the back of your business card. So for those of you whose eyes are still younger and more fertile than mine, this is Larry's new book, and I encourage you all to go out and buy it, or even better yet, download it. Larry, the floor is yours.
And free business cards from the internet. That's the best thing of all. Well, thank you very much, and welcome on behalf of the Georgetown Center for Business and Public Policy. We're delighted to be partnering here with the Lisbon Council. I'm going to make my comments a little bit more formal than I usually do, just given the sort of august nature of the earlier speakers. And in particular, I was reflecting on Vice President Kroes's comments, and I think they really underscore a really important reality about innovation and regulation. And that is that innovation, thanks to exponential technological trends, including things like Moore's Law and Metcalfe's Law, get faster and more disruptive all the time. That's the phenomenon my co-author and I refer to as Big Bang Disruption. Regulation, on the other hand, happens at the same pace at best. And even the most well-intentioned regulators, and I certainly include Vice President Kroes in that list, find in retrospect that interventions aimed at heading off possible competitive problems and potential consumer harms rarely achieve their objectives and indeed generate harmful unintended consequences. Now, I don't see that as a failure of government. I think the problem is that the clock speeds of innovation and regulation are simply different, and they're diverging faster all the time. Fortunately, I think, the internet economy has been governed from its inception by the engineering-driven multi-stakeholder process that we heard about so much earlier, embodied in the task forces and standards groups that operate under the umbrella of the Internet Society in particular. The bottom line, though, is that innovation, I think for better or for worse, certainly in the digital agenda, is regulated more by Moore's Law than by traditional law. That's not a failure of government. I think that's really a for better rather than a for worse. But I should say I'm not one of those who take that to the extreme of saying there's no role for government, traditional governments in the digital economy. They have and continue to play an essential part in laying the foundation for the remarkable growth of that economy and for providing incentives, if not sometimes actual funding, for basic research that otherwise might not find private investment. And more importantly, when genuine market failures do occur, traditional regulators can and should and do step in to correct them as efficiently and as narrowly as possible. Sometimes that's happened, sometimes it hasn't. And I think where in particular I find the regulatory intervention the least effective and most dangerous is in regulating ahead of problems, in enacting what the FCC has called prophylactic rules. The effort in particular to create legally sound open internet regulations, and there's actually task force roundtable going on right now down the street at the FCC on this point, has faltered repeatedly, and yet in the interim, investment in both the infrastructure and the applications world continue at a rapid pace, in fact, far outstripping the rest of the world. Speak for themselves. In this light touch regulatory regime we've had, U.S. companies dominate the digital economy, and as Professor Christopher Yu has definitively demonstrated, U.S. consumers overall enjoy the best wired and mobile infrastructures in the world. At the same time, those who continue to pursue interventionist regulation in this area, I think, often have hidden agendas, and I want to give you three examples. As we saw earlier this month at the Internet Governance Forum, which I attended along with the Vice President Kroes and about 3,000 delegates, representatives of the developing world were told by so-called consumer advocates from the US and the EU that they must reject zero-rated services, where mobile operators partner with service providers, including Facebook, Twitter, and Wikimedia, to provide their popular services to new internet users without incurring data costs, without actually applying to any data usage. Zero rating is an extremely popular tool for helping the two-thirds of the world's population that don't currently have internet access get connected and likely to go from those services to the rest of the internet. But such services violate the principle of neutrality that has mutated from an engineering concept to a nearly religious conviction. And so zero rating must be sacrificed, we were told, along with users who are too poor to otherwise join the digital economy. Second example, closer to home, we see the wildly successful company Netflix making a play to hijack the open internet debate into one about back-end interconnection, peering, and transit, engineering features that work so well that 99% of the agreements involved, according to the OECD, aren't even written down. And then finally, in Europe, there are other efforts to turn the neutrality principle, as vague as it is, on its head and use it as a hammer not to regulate access providers, but to slow the progress of dominant content and service providers, including Apple, Amazon, and Google, who have what the French Digital Council recently referred to as platform monopolies that must be broken. Now, to me, these are, in fact, new faces of very old strategies: colonialism, rent-seeking, and trade warfare, respectively. My hope is that internet users, an increasingly powerful and independent source of regulatory discipline in this economy, will see these efforts for what they truly are and reject them resoundingly. The more we trust, but also verify, the engineers, the faster the internet economy will grow, I think, both in the US and Europe, and the greater our trade in digital goods and services will strengthen the ties between our traditional economies as well. It has worked brilliantly for almost two decades. The alternatives, not so much. Thanks.
Larry, thank you for that very clear and also inspiring call to arms on some of the very real threats and problems that exist out there. We've heard from now, for the sake of balance, it's time to hear from two Europeans, starting with my colleague Ann Mettler, who's already been introduced today. But since we're in the business of praising others for their leadership on the digital agenda, let me just say, Ann, it's been an honor and a privilege to have you as a colleague, because you have led on this issue, particularly in the European context. And we're delighted you can be here today to share your thoughts with us here in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paul. And well, reflecting on the topic of today, growing the transatlantic digital economy, I just want to say something that I've told my friends repeatedly over the last couple of days. And even if it sounds like a cliche, we really, really have to restore trust and confidence. On the European side, it's very, very much broken. Karen spoke about Germany and the deterioration of the perception of the United States. I am German, and I grew up in Germany, and I can tell you that at my when I was a child, all Germans, pretty much all Germans, were really, really strong and committed transatlanticists, and it's changing. And I observe this with great concern. And in particular, in this space on digital, I have to observe that very, very slowly, but really over for quite a long time now, but with a marked deterioration, I would say, in the last 6 to 8 weeks, really, really a kind of language and words used about this perceived dominance of the United States in this space that I find very surprising and very shocking and frankly very disturbing. Now, part of this is obviously due to the Snowden revelations, but I also have to say, along with what Neelie Kroes said here earlier today, I mean, the fact is, yes, we are very concerned, but there are more users of Google and Facebook in Europe on a percentage basis than here in the United States. So, I mean, largely speaking, yes, the policymakers are very concerned, but the users are not abandoning these services in droves. And I think it's something we have to keep in mind. But going back to Europe in general, I think in trying to identify and analyze what is happening, there is a real, real pronounced fear of decline. And I think also a little bit of frustration that digital was seen for a long time in Europe as something very much like a silo issue. It was delegated to telecommunications ministers. The Europeans really were slow to understand it's a general purpose technology that is not just about the ICT sector itself, but it's really about disrupting and changing the entire economy, and not just the economy, but also societies. Paul talked about the impact on democracy. I think we were really, really really slow to wrap our minds around in Europe, and now to some extent we're paying the price for this. What I always tell the Europeans is there is nothing to be afraid of. There is nothing but opportunity out there, and Europe can compete or connect, as you would maybe say, Mike, and I just want to give you a couple of examples. I am convinced that the next phase of digital, which is primarily about the Internet of Things and digitalization of industry, holds huge benefit for Europe. In Europe, we pride ourselves that we still know how to make good things that the rest of the world wants to buy. We're very strong on industry and manufacturing. If you combine that with digitalization, it really is a recipe for success. I think it'll lead to reshoring. It will lead to innovations that aren't easy to replicate elsewhere. Just to say, before the summer, Paul and I were invited by the Bavarian Economics Ministry to come to Munich and to see what they're doing about this. Companies like BMW working together with really clever startups, with accelerators, a conducive policy environment, and world-class research institutes such as Fraunhofer. So my point is, there is a lot happening in this space that maybe is not sufficiently recognized, and Europe can really compete here. The other example I wanted to give, and Neelie Kroes mentioned it, is the app economy, which is actually very healthy in Europe. It's about roughly the same size as here in the United States. 4 out of 5 of the most popular gaming apps come out of Europe. The sector itself employs about 1.8 million people by now. It's projected to grow to over 4 million in a place that has double-digit unemployment. Trust me, this is nothing to be taken lightly. So my point is, you know, there's really a lot happening here. The third example is on digital entrepreneurship. I know the United States is obviously leading here, but there was a very interesting research study that recently came out that looked at so-called unicorns, so fast-growing companies in the digital space that are valued at over €1 billion. And what the study showed is that between the year 2000 and 2013, Europe created 30 unicorns, so companies that are valued at over $1 billion. In the, roughly the same time frame, the United States created 39 companies of that size. So, you know, even though the United States did better, I have to say that on balance, we Europeans were very positively surprised that, you know, that we actually did quite well and we can play in this space. So what does this all mean for the transatlantic digital agenda? For me, it means first and foremost that Europe needs to really regain its confidence. It has to be a positive digital agenda, not in opposition to the United States, not being defensive, but really seizing this opportunity for new sources of growth and new jobs that need to be created. So, from the American side, I have to say, maybe, yes, you're very, very successful, and I recognize that and I applaud you for it, but maybe you could be a little bit better in anticipating some of the sort of challenges and threats that might be emerging. One is, we already talked about it, the prospect of a balkanized internet. There were, after Snowden, after all of this came out, there were very serious discussions about a European internet. I mean, completely crazy, you know, but this was a really serious debate. So I think that's a huge threat. On data as well, I think that in Europe, the debate is... it's almost impossible to conduct on data. I mean, it is very, very difficult. What I always say in my speeches on data is, you know, not all data is personal data. I mean, there's a lot of what I would describe as just, you know, randomized industrial data that we need. And in this actually trip that we had to Munich, there wasn't a person or a company or an entrepreneur or a policymaker that we talked to who wasn't very concerned about where the debate on data was going in Europe. So when you talk to people who are in biotech, how are you going to do personalized medicine if you can't collect anyone's data? I mean, how is all of this supposed to work? You know, if you talk to one of the world's leading car companies, how is this all the connected car supposed to work if you can't collect data? So my point is we really need to go into very detailed areas and tell people that data is not about making certain companies, particularly on this side of the Atlantic, rich, but it's really about making people's lives better. And I think this is a story that hasn't been told other than by Paul and Mike, by the way, so thank you for that. And the third one I would like to mention is there is, at least in Europe, I don't know here, but increasingly we're seeing that technology and digital advancement is very much associated with inequality. And this is particularly in the European context, which is a place that takes social cohesion and inclusion very seriously. This is a very, very dangerous way of talking about this. I recently had the opportunity to address a very, very senior audience of economic policymakers and talking about digital, and almost all of the questions I received afterwards were around inequality. And I think, you know, I mean, the example in that particular discussion was given was that it was about Italy. And I said about Italy, look, 70% of your workforce is low skilled. This is driving inequality. This is, you know, want to live in one of the richest and most prosperous places in the world and be low skilled? 70% of your workforce, good luck sustaining your prosperity. You know, so I think here we just need a more nuanced discussion. And just to close on this, I think it's very important to be upbeat, not to be naive about things, but I see nothing but opportunity. If I compare the opportunities that I had compared to the opportunities my mother had, it is extraordinary. And much of that was powered by digital technologies because it's so much cheaper today to start not just companies, but also think tanks, by the way. So, you know, I mean, there's just so much more you can do than in the past. And I feel personally very empowered. So just to say, I actually had the privilege of living in the United States many years ago. I came here in 1993. And back then, the story about the United States was the US is finished. It's all about Japan. And Japan is going to lead the way, and they're so innovative. And there was really sort of this feeling that I sense now in Europe was in the United States back then. And look at how you turn things around. We started the Lisbon Council in 2003. This is not very long ago, 11 years ago. At that time, Germany was considered the sick man of Europe. It had the highest unemployment since the Weimar Republic. There was nothing but a feeling that Germany is finished. Look at Germany today, 11 years later. And I think this is exactly the message that we need to give people. We can turn things around. We can thrive again. And we can be a community of values and of prosperity. And this is the transatlantic digital economy. So thank you for that.
Our next speaker is Antonio De Lucia, Principal Advisor of the Delegation of the European Commission to the United States. A couple of short words, if I could, Antonio, before you start speaking. Now, first of all, my sympathies. I quite often have to speak after Anne Mettler at Lisbon Council events, and it's very difficult because she sets a very high standard, although I know for a fact that you can meet it, but I wanted to say I understand the way you're feeling right now. And secondly, I also wanted to thank you too, Antonio, not just for your leadership on this issue and in transatlantic trade and investment partnership, but as you know, we've known each other a long time.
Absolutely.
And I think one could even make a case that the Lisbon Council would not be here today if it wasn't for your very kind assistance and support in the very early days when you were a young aide to European Commission President Romano Prodi. We remember those times very warmly, and we remember the time we spent with you. And we've grown a bit since then, and so have you. And it's a pleasure to have you back with us again and to meet you again, and we look forward to all you have to say.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you. And indeed, that shows the advantages of investing in startups. So at the time, it was a nascent think tank, but I mean, what you have done since, it's remarkable, and thank you for that. And you're right, I mean, coming after Anne is a challenge, but let me take the challenge and start by saying that I can subscribe to most of what you had said, but not to everything. And particularly, yes, you are right that there are plenty of opportunities. There are immense opportunities with the digital economy. But don't underestimate the risks. And just focusing on the advantages is fundamental, and we all do that, and we should continue to do that. But if we neglect some of the risks, then we may have backlash effects, as you are now seeing and you were referring to in some countries. So I'll try to come back to Paul's initial questions of what how we see the potential, the risks, and what we need to do. And to start with, the potential for us is very important. We see there are studies, some of them supported by the Lisbon Council, of the Conference Board, our own studies in the European Commission show that indeed part of the stalling of productivity or even decline of productivity can be traced to the fact that ICT, in the production and absorption of ICT has been lower broadly speaking, in Europe than it has been here. So this, again, it's a challenge, but it creates an opportunity. If we do more in this respect, we will be able to increase our subdued growth, and therefore to overcome the latest stage of the crisis and to really get back into a pace of stable and high growth. So that's clear. As you know, the EU has in its DNA the concept and the objective of integrating markets, and the digital connectivity is one and is another way of integrating markets, and therefore you will find in the European Commission and the EU institutions at large a big support for that. So it's also in our DNA the concept of creating a level playing field. So this is again one of the, and I will come back to one of the to-dos that we are undertaking in the EU, and that can also be applicable to the broader global community. So we understand that it is and from the economic point of view, as I said, the ICTs are a general purpose technology that can permeate all sectors. And I'll come back to that as well, because we also see that it's not only the production by the ICT sector, but it's also the absorption. And the absorption is partly, that comes partly through investment, but partly through what ICT enables in terms of restructuring firms and organizations. And in this respect, it's also important that it comes along with more flexibility and other structural reforms that currently may prevent the benefits from ICT to be incorporated into both the private sector and in the administration. So Anne also mentioned the issue of inequality. Inequality may be increased by ICT, and the digital divide is a fact. But it's also true, and I would agree with Anne, that it's also an opportunity. It's an opportunity for reaching to the under endowed or low endowed sectors of the population, and bring them into the into higher levels of income. So again, not long ago, the EU was praised in a report by the World Bank as a convergent machine. So an institutional setting that brought low-income countries and accompanied them into higher income. So this may also be fostered through the digital economy and the digital society. Yes, there are risks, but there are opportunities. There are opportunities, but there are also risks. So let me come to the risks. The risks are basically, as we see them in the EU, are first of all trust. And trust applies to data privacy, certainly, but also applies to the forging of identity. So de-identification is an issue. You will not have consumers buying products online if they are not sure, or they don't have some kind of assurance that that their identity will not be supplanted, and that their data will not be passed on to people that shouldn't have them. So that's a second element of trust, is that of security. We need, besides the security of identities, we need the security of data. So the cyber type of security is also important, and we look at it quite carefully. Another element that was partly mentioned is the fragmentation of regulations. Clearly, it's completely at odds with connectivity to have different and incompatible, inconsistent regulations. Certainly within Europe, but also this is also applicable to transatlantic and to the global economy. So now let me go into what we need to do, and which is basically just the other side of what I have said. So what we need to do is to foster production and absorption of ICTs and creating a level playing field. So creating a single market of digital products, and for that we need to stop the fragmentation of regulations, and we need to remove other obstacles to the absorption by firms and public administrations into their own operations. This is where, as I said, it's not only it doesn't suffice to have the sector itself being brought into a level playing field and to have a high growth, but we need to remove other obstacles that prevent the benefits from ICT to be passed on to the rest of the economy through, as I said, restructuring the capacity to restructure to slim operations when they are possible to be slimmed because of ICT. So we need to address promotion of the ICT sector with other structural reforms that will bring more flexibility into the economy. And this is the good news is that if we look at both the priorities and the organization of the new commission presided by Jean-Claude Juncker, you find all these elements very clearly in their amongst their priorities. If you look at, at first glance at the organization of the new commission, President Juncker has identified 10 flagship projects for his commission. And the single digital market is one of them, and this one is an important one. So he has appointed a vice president for the digital society and economy that will have as task to coordinate other commissioners and the services, so as to bring this level playing field and to bring to push forward legislation. Slim down that regulation that may prevent or that may hinder the development of the single market in digital products. So that's a clear signal of how important he sees this for the EU economy and the EU society. And if you look in the letter of mission that he has sent to both the Vice President for Digital Economy and to the actual Commissioner, you see a number of other more precise priorities that he mandates them to produce, for instance, within the next six months, to give more ambition to the reform of the telecoms rules, or to copyright, or to the radio waves, and to address also the security and cybersecurity. So he also points to the need not only to create a level playing field, but also to promote investment, and to enable the conditions for investment to flourish in the area as well. And there, one element that he cites is legal certainty. So once these rules within the EU are harmonized or made consistent, this will provide private operators with the legal certainty that will make investment more interesting and more rewarding. He has asked his commissioners to review competition and taxation rules that may also hinder the investment in ICT. He has asked them, together with other commissioners, to look into ways to promote the rollout of infrastructure, and namely broadband, that again can provide a public support to a faster internet and faster absorption of ICT. And he proposes to promote again the digital industry content by supporting innovative and content in media and others. And he also puts emphasis on the absorption of the new technologies into government, particularly within the EU institutions, so in relations with our member state governments, but also with individuals. And therefore, to give one more way to foster the industry. So, and what we say about the EU is very much applicable to the transatlantic economy. So, indeed, the level playing field is an element that is crucial in the development of this trust between both sides of the Atlantic, the enabling of conditions for investment, but by again providing certainty to investors is something that applies on both sides and that may help the transatlantic digital market. And many other things, not least the data protection and privacy that Anne referred to. And I will stop there and thank you.
I do believe I put the room on warning very early on that we didn't want to just talk to you. We actually want to hear from you. And in that spirit, I'd like to open the floor to questions and comments. I see right away 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. As quickly as you can get to them, Sloan, let's do them all. Over there is fine, too. And just I'll say to my panelists as well, we'll take some questions and comments, and we'll come back to all of you at the end to respond to some of what you've heard already and to answer some of these questions, too. Who has the microphone here? Yes, the lady there, please. And can you introduce yourself?
Of course. I'm Dr. Susan Aronson from George Washington University. I do research on trade and digital trade and human rights. But I want to talk about how the market has changed. More and more, the internet is developing countries, citizens of developing countries, as you know, and three now of the biggest internet companies are Chinese. So clearly the norm setters on the demand side and supply side are going to be in the developing world. I had hoped that we would have clear provisions on free flow in TTIP, and we'd have a sense of that. What does this mean for setting of the norms if we don't have those clear provisions? That's my question.
Okay, thank you. You said a very nice and easy question. Thank you. We'll take some more, and then we'll come back, and the panelists can handle that as they would like. I saw it just here.
Yeah. Yes. Tom Goldberg, and with Lineage. The World Economic Forum last year came out with a report indicating that security is going to impact international trade, West-West primarily, to the tune of between 3 to 13 trillion in the next decade. Earlier this year, McKinsey came out with a monograph suggesting that companies that are going to compete in the digital era have to reinvent their IT entirely. In that meaning, it's a double entendre. One is to compete digitally, one has to be disruptive, but the other one was to get at digital attackers from the point of view of security. I'd be interested in your comments on either of those.
Okay, thank you. The gentleman here in the second row.
Thank you. Dieter Detke, Georgetown University. On the issue of internet governance, I think that's a real critical issue. And it seems to me that time is really of the essence. And can you shed a little more light on what's happening on that score, and in particular on the approach, which is the correct one, that we have to have a multiple stakeholder interest in this? Where do we stand here? In the meantime, I would say that look at what's happening in the courts. The European Courts of Justice talks about the right to be forgotten. The German Constitutional Court talks about informational self-determination, which runs counter to what Anne told us here today. And then look at the Uber decisions in Germany, trying to stop the process. There's talk about breaking up Google, and all kinds of things are happening on that level, on the court level. And these are big issues. I mean, these, you know, are conflicting issues too. And so where is the stakeholder approach in order to get some clarity into the system? Can you shed some light on this, where we stand? And did we identify the stakeholders properly? Are they available? Do they contribute to a process? Where is the process? Who runs the process? And I would like to know a little more about this, because yes, a stakeholder, multiple stakeholder approach is great, but where is it? It has to be, you know, achieve something. Thank you.
That's a very good question. I would argue that we're all stakeholders, by the way. I would argue we're all stakeholders in this debate. Can the gentleman here? Yes, I understand. You're talking process and theory.
Thank you. George is Mihaios. I'm currently associated with Kent State University, but I've been working in Europe for a few years, and I monitored three integrated projects related to digital economy, the large one. So I have some experience on the European side. What you said about US and Europe and the perception, alarming acceleration of negative perception of US in Europe, I think it goes very far. At the same time, sorry, I make some statement to introduce my question. At the same time, we face challenges not far away in Asia, but next door in Ukraine. And what was good with Ukraine, that Europe at last got mobilized to do something about it. My question is, there are many diagnostic studies, lack of symmetry, why Europe cannot cooperate with US or can. My impression is, when we have a big problem to solve, not necessary to face the same a war, like Second World War or Ukraine, but Ukraine proved that Europe and US can get together when we have a big problem to solve. One of the big problems I noticed both in America and all over the world is we have in America 16 million youths from 6.7 million youths from 16 to 24 years old, out of job, out of school. We have proportionately the same situation in Europe. Can you identify, saying, let's use digital economy possibilities and to address one of the big issues, not just critical security type of issue, this issue, how do we integrate those youths in the society? You have hikikomori in Japan and so on, but how do we integrate? Can we launch an initiative, Lisbon Council with PPI, and then we mobilize our resources and our differences as well? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Now, ordinarily I would cut this off and go back to the panel, because these questions get to be rather meaty and hard to remember. Does anyone want to come in now, or should I continue with a few more?
Can you get us some easier questions?
Let's just get two more questions
and then we'll
sure. What's the capital of South Dakota? We'll take some more questions then, if that's okay, and then we come back to you guys.
I have, I'm Dennis Kroes, I'm in the telecommunications industry, and somewhat similar to Frau Mettler, I lived in Germany, had the privilege of living in Germany for 5 years, in Brussels for a couple years, and I'm baffled by my fellow Americans, and I was wondering whether maybe Larry or Mike could comment on why is it that the Americans don't seem to care about data privacy? We have this transatlantic digital data privacy divide, and it seems to be dramatic right now, as a number of people have commented on. And so the question is, why do you think the Americans don't care about their credit card data or a lot of privacy? And what is it that we as Americans can do to try to address that such that we might be able to get some common value with the Europeans? Because we're dramatically separated on this issue.
Thank you. And there were some more questions in this part of the room. Yeah, thanks. We get to you too. Thanks.
Good morning, and thank you. Ken Levinson with Rasmussen Public Affairs. And it's somewhat of an easier question in some ways, perhaps, that you were looking for. But I'm wondering, where are the companies that rely on the internet in the conduct of their business that are not typically e-commerce and internet companies? It's been referred to quite a bit about the internet as a general purpose technology. But whenever I go to these discussions, and I've gone to quite a few of them over the last number of months, it's always the internet-oriented companies that are here. You don't see the industrial companies that rely on the internet for the conduct of their business in this conversation. I'm just wondering what we need to do to pull them into this conversation.
It's a good question, and one that we're working on very actively in Europe, because I completely agree with you. We all have a stake in this, including companies that still think it's a silo issue. By the way, not all of them. There are pillars in those companies that do understand, and I wish more of them were here today. The gentleman there?
By pure luck, I have exactly a comment that is an answer to your question. I'm Chris Bledavsky from Manufacturers Alliance for Productivity and Innovation.
Hey, this ties we didn't set this up, I swear.
No, it's not set up. Also, in reference to what Anne was mentioning, I conducted a survey very recently among very senior U.S.-based executives of very large American companies, manufacturing companies, on TTIP. So let me quote from two questions and two responses, which is exactly what you were asking. One question I phrased roughly the following. When you look at Europe, and all of these companies are exposed to Europe big time, and look at TTIP, on intellectual protection in Europe, would you accept what the Europeans are legislating and proposing in terms of intellectual property and take it wholesale into the TTIP agreement? Upwards of three quarters, almost 80%, said, yes, we have absolutely no problem.
Really?
We love what the Europeans are doing on intellectual property. It's fine with us. We can operate under these rules. That's great. I ask another question. I ask about two dozen questions. But another one was on the digital economy, in particular on data transfers and data privacy. Do you like what the Europeans are doing? Would you take what they are proposing and incorporate that into TTIP? By a margin of upwards of 3-1, almost 4-1, they say no. We have so much trouble with data protection, data operation in Europe. We find that we have to have better solutions, otherwise we'll lower our productivity. We cannot operate as efficiently in Europe under these new standards as we do in the United States. Thanks. Okay.
Thank you. And I saw a hand in the back here. Yeah, we'll come to you in a second. We're okay.
Running out of space to write things down.
Thank you. Job Henning, co-founder of LinkPad. We depend a lot on human telemetric data, so I'll ask the question kind of from a different angle. privacy and sort of the lack of interest is sort of mystifying here in the United States. On the other hand, I think it's kind of equally mystifying why it's taken so long to think about the value of data in Europe and in the digital economy. So if we could pick up on Anne's comments, you indicated there was something happening inside of the European economy. There was a growing awareness of kind of how this could cost a lot in terms of innovation over time. If you could expand on that and where you see that going from here.
Okay, thanks. And on that note, unless there's a burning question left, I'm going to cut this off now and go back to the panelists. But first, I'm going to critically abuse my power as moderator and add one more question to the mix as well. And don't worry, it's a simple one, and it's not about the capital of South Dakota. The question is, we've been here now for a couple of hours talking about this. My question is, what have you learned? What takeaways will you bring from this discussion with you? How will you describe it to your significant others when you get home later this evening? And what have you heard being discussed today? We'll start down at the end with Antonio and work our way back down through the panel to Michael last. Antonio?
Thank you. Well, I'll pick two or three of the questions.
Please.
The issue of security, I refer to that. Indeed, it's crucial. And others mentioned the geopolitical tensions Well, we know that some of our member states have been more or less systematically attacked in this way. So we don't take it lightly. And the more the data spread and we know that the potential of using big data in to increase productivity exists in many other areas than in IT. The sensors and the Internet of Things, the data mining services companies. So that creates enormous opportunities, but also enormous risks if these data flows are not secure. So then I'll go back to the issue of the perception amongst American companies of the intellectual property and data privacy, and related to the different approaches by consumers in the EU and the US. Yes, Anne, I think, mentioned that the take-up of Google and other social media in Europe is really very high. But when you end up knowing that you may have a lesser capacity to redress some mistakes. So if your data are gathered or used or recorded, if someone from Europe has less possibilities to redress some mistake than someone from the US, well, then you may explain to some extent where the difference of approach and opinion may be. So if an American citizen can take the case up to the courts, but the European doesn't, well, that makes a difference. And this difference at least must be acknowledged, and some kind of readiness to close the gap must be expected from the authorities. And this is what we haven't had so far, which explains the overreaction in some quarters, at least in terms of proposals, that make some of these proposals really very cumbersome. But they are cumbersome because they haven't found other ways to really provide the minimum protection for its citizens. So it is in the interest of both sides to try and see whether there are filing the efficiency and effectiveness with some legitimate aspiration of data privacy and protection. So that's what I would like to add to that. And as takeaways, I will go back and continue preaching for the high potential and the need to really embrace the ICT technologies. And I see that this is more or less unanimous, if not completely unanimous, and with more determination to try and find these ways of really making the transatlantic digital market a reality, and even bring it beyond that to have a global governance of internet that is not only transatlantic but.
Thank you, Antonio, and I hope I'm not giving state secrets away here, but if I understand correctly, what you were discussing just now is exactly what's being discussed in the dialogue between the Europeans and the Americans, the issue of redress and level playing field. Anne, would you like to take a few questions?
Thank you so much, and thank you also for your very, very good questions. My first two comments are around TTIP. And the rise of these very large Chinese companies. And I think that's very good for us to remember on both sides of the Atlantic. And what I always say in my speeches in Europe on TTIP, and trust me, these are not easy interventions to give, but what I say is if we as Europe and the United States don't come together, then China will set the standards. And then let's have another discussion around consumer rights and around environmental protection. You know, so I really, really believe this. Europe right now is 5% of the world's population. 20, 30 years, we're talking about 3-4%. So, I mean, if we want to have a say in Europe, we are much better off in a transatlantic alliance on trade. And the second point I wanted to make, and this again, something that I really believe is when we talk about TTIP, it's so just, it's about big companies and about just economic interests. But I think that the recent developments have really shown us that this is essentially a geostrategic strategy, because we have just, I mean, maybe we are more, you know, exposed to this in Europe, but what's happening in Ukraine is very threatening. This is on our doorstep. What's happening in the Middle East, you know, all the migrants coming to Europe because of these terrible situations in their countries. You have Ebola in Africa, you know, you have in Europe, because the economy is not, we haven't recovered from the crisis. You have a rise of real xenophobic parties. You have populism. You have separatist movements. This is really, really threatening. So my point is, this is more than a trade agreement. This is a geostrategic agenda. And I think it's very important that some other voices be heard here than just big CEOs of companies or so. You know, there is much more at stake here. And let's face it, if we don't get TTIP, this is a once-in-a-generation opportunity. It will be dead for many, many years, because we were not going to go back there. So this is really something that we have to keep in mind. On the question on why are there not more industrial companies speaking out on this, completely agree. And we've been working tirelessly in Europe to try to get some new players in the debate. So one of the examples I mentioned last night at dinner is, for instance, Telefonica, which is a very successful Spanish telecommunications company, has a new campaign now saying data, the new currency. You know, we've also trying to give more voice to startup entrepreneurs. So we're working on a study right now on European startups that have data as their business model, and you know, interviewing them and trying to bring them to Brussels. It's very important that the Europeans understand that they have a stake in this. I mean, if we have completely unworkable legislation at the end of this, sure, it'll harm American companies, but first and foremost, it's going to harm European companies, and I think we really need to understand that. So, and on data as well, let me say that, I mean, there are so many things in Europe that we care about, be it smart cities, be it sustainability, be it healthcare, the aging of the population. Data will help drive this forward. You know, smart cities, Amsterdam and Stockholm, they're at the forefront of this, but it cannot be done without data. On sustainability, smart meters, you know, huge opportunity. These are issues that we as Europeans care about. We need to make the link with data, you know, and explain to people that it can improve our lives and our economies. Lastly, on what I have learned, it's been very interesting for me to spend the last, whatever, you know, 72 hours here in the United States, because usually when you come here as a European, you don't get a lot of attention or a lot of interest. Oh. But we, but there has been really just unprecedented interest in talking to us and saying, what is going on in Europe? You know, we just don't understand. So, you know,
if you could do a Scottish accent, you would have gotten even more.
No, the question that the gentleman asked to the two of you, my feeling is there is now more sensitivity. There is more of an understanding. We do need to listen. Maybe they do have a point. Let's come together. As I said, this is a huge opportunity because, frankly, also the United States needs new sources of growth, new jobs. So, you know, let's not pass this moment is my message, and it's what I take home.
Thank you. Larry?
Okay, thank you. I'll try two of the questions, and then I'll take your takeaway question as well. Dennis's question about privacy. I have an hypothesis for a long time that there really is significant historical and cultural differences between the U.S. and Europe that explain, I think, why the attitudes toward privacy, generally speaking, are so different. You know, the U.S. was started by sort of radically transparent religious parties, the Puritans, who, if you ever read the Scarlet Letter, you understand that, you know, there is no such thing as privacy in a Puritan town. And at the same time, moving west on the frontier, there was this idea, which is now obviously very much mythologized, but that you could go west and disappear, you could reinvent yourself, you could become a different person and be completely private. And so in some sense, we have a very schizophrenic view about privacy. And it's reflected, I think, in the fact that you do these surveys saying, how important is privacy to you? And Americans all say, it's very, very important. Then you say, would you, you know, give up all your private information for a coupon? And they'd immediately do it. So it's very hard. And I think, you know, some of the reason why there isn't as much anxiety, at least in the US, is some of these problems are not really the same problem that we think they are. So the credit card problem you mentioned, when there are these hijackings of credit card numbers, you know, by and large, the system has already dealt with the liability such that the liability rests with the party who should have the liability, which is the credit card processors and the banks. Individual consumers are more or less immune. Now, if you have experienced identity theft, you know it's a hassle. But from a financial law standpoint, it generally isn't as big an issue. Having said that, I think the big problem still with the financial stuff is many companies, including financial, but even retail companies, have done still a very poor job of implementing even basic sort of ISO level security for their data standards. And what would, I think, make them more compliant would be better transparency. So forcing them to disclose when there have been breaches, I think, would really help, you know, incentivize them even more than they've already been incentivized. The question about governance from my colleague at Georgetown. So as I said in my statement, you know, up until now, internet governance, at least in terms of the actual internet itself, in terms of the network architecture, has been essentially an engineering-driven multi-stakeholder process. And that worked really well when it was, you know, not a force of economic and social change. Now that it's become, you know, sort of the information economy has now become the economy, it's understandable that that model is being challenged. The problem is, we understand that the stakeholders who are missing, to answer your question, are obviously the governments. And the problem is, every time they start to enter the conversation, it gets hijacked. So it's, you know, Iran and China and Russia, who in fact don't want the internet at all. They want to make sure that the internet is gone or under as much control as possible. And so the conversation about how to involve governments immediately turns into how do the governments, certain repressive governments, how do they take over the internet? And the conversation ends. I think that's what happened at the Wicket in Dubai. And you know, it's just so far the bringing together of the traditional engineering-driven stakeholder model, bringing now in governments to solve some of the problems that you mentioned, you know, right to be forgotten and so on, it just hasn't worked yet. And every time, and I think your Uber example is good as well, because it suggests that when the governments do get involved, they get involved on the side of you know, trying to retain the status quo or trying to protect the regulated incumbent. Also doesn't really, you know, give them a lot of credibility with the engineers. So, you know, for now, I wouldn't say I'm comfortable with things as they are, but having been an engineer, having been in government, having been a lawyer, and having been in academia, the fact that it's still largely with the engineers doesn't make me feel bad. Among those four groups, that's the one I trust the most. And finally, Paul, to my takeaway, I think when I was thinking back, I was thinking back to sort of 1995 and the first EU privacy directives. I think we would say that, let's say 1995, kind of at the dawn of the commercial internet, the US and EU were very, very far apart, philosophically, regulatory, economic, and so on their attitude toward how this technology should be developed and how it should be deployed. And I think what I would say is, you know, from today, but more generally, that in 2014, I think both the US and EU have moved closer together. You know, the U.S. has become, I think, more sensitive about privacy. I think the EU has become more sensitive about sort of protectionist policies. So I think there's been significant progress, but certainly not enough.
Thank you. And by the way, thank you for being such gracious hosts to us today, too.
Our
Mike?
So there's been a lot of discussion here in the comments and questions about broad principles such as data privacy, inequality, security, who's the stakeholder. And the question is, what's the broad principle on the other side? Well, we could say that it's economic growth, but that's not really big enough. So I actually want to go back to what I raised at the beginning, which is connectedness. I don't just mean connectedness in the sense you have a device and is connected to the network. It's not simply digital. If you're a young person and you don't have a job, the fact that you've got a smartphone and connected to the network doesn't make you connected. You have got to be connected to people. If you're a country and you happen to have people are sort of wired, but there's protectionism between you and the rest of the world, you're not connected. So I'd like to suggest that perhaps the broad principle that we're missing on the other side is connectedness in the broad sense. Digitally connected, connected across borders, connected to other people, and that we should think about policy in terms of what improves connectedness. Because we know from an economic point of view that connectedness is a positive thing for growth, but it also has social implications, it has political implications. When you mention Ebola, okay, the connectedness of Africa with the rest of the world makes it easier to garner support, to bring in and bring help. When we're sort of talking about the Ukraine, the fact there's a tension there between what Russia can do and the connectedness with the rest of the world. I think we should start thinking about connectedness in the broad sense as the principle that in some sense is the flip principle to data privacy. Data privacy is the right to be by yourself. Connectedness is the ability to be connected to the rest of society, to the rest of the world. And I think in the end, this may help us make some of the policy decisions that are tough to make at this point. And what I've learned, you're a great guy.
Okay. I thought you knew that.
Oh, I knew that already.
And on that note, let's thank our panelists warmly. By the way, if you don't mind, I'm once again going to abuse my position as moderator and answer my own question about what I will take away from this event. And I think it's two things, both are very clearly in the realm of principle, as you said, Mike, because we've discussed a lot of principles here today. I think the internet is a tremendous opportunity. It's a general purpose technology. It's an empowering technology. It's given us all, and I use the word all deliberately because it's an inclusive, open platform. It's given us all the capacity, the ability to learn, to communicate, to become one world, as you said just a moment ago. But it's also a responsibility, because those things didn't just fall from the sky. There were a lot of very clever people in the beginning who set it up as an open platform in the way that it is now, and that's why it's there for all of our use today. What I wrote in my notes here was, like freedom, like democracy, it relies on citizens to remain open and viable. And that's the message I'd like you all to take home with you today. Because without your support on this issue, I mean, we're not just talking about policy today, we're talking about the world we live in. And without your support on this issue, there will be problems and they will overtake us. And maybe this will just be a fillip in history rather than a foundation for a new era of prosperity, which is what we'd all like to see. Let me just briefly on that note, more mundane matters, I'd like first of all to thank the team that created this event today. First of all, from PPI, Lindsay Lewis, Sloan Hurst, and Stephen Klapeka, who you've been silent today. But,
Tony Tucker, too.
And Cody Tucker, too, you've been silent today, but your voice has spoken very loudly through your actions, and we really appreciate all that you did. And also to my own team back in Brussels, who, if I'm not mistaken, are probably watching us live now on the live video stream. Thanks, guys. You did a tremendous job. We really do appreciate it. And on that note, let me just say coffee is served. I hope you can all stay for a while, get to know your friends and your neighbors, because you're a very interesting audience. We weren't able to answer all of the questions in the question time, so maybe you have a chance to come up and speak to some of our speakers again. And that leads me to the last people to thank, which are you. Thanks for coming.